We built that place in 180 days from the day we broke ground to opening night. 1,000 folks, and of course on a good night we'd run a couple thousand through that place. Opened it in February 20th, 1979 with Spirit. And first night you open a club and you got a sellout. We got 1,000 people day one. It's not selling any alibis as you stare into the vacuum of his. Second night is Charlie Daniels Band. And of course that's a jammed house as well, and the place is really jumping. And I remember Charlie Daniels comes up to me and he said, "Mr. Soenen," he said, "I hope you got this roof tied down really tight, because we are going to blow the roof off this place tonight." Absolutely fantastic show. The club just took off like wildfire. We had arrangement with Brass Ring Productions to book all the talent, so they were booking a lot of the big shows throughout the Midwest, and they would do a stopover at the club. We would do them Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday night, and we had our local talent on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, and disco was on Sunday night. So Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, the big acts are moving through town. Brass Ring would book them into our club, and you know, hung out six shows, $10 ticket. Tina Turner, $10 ticket. Alabama was a $5 ticket. Dire Straits, $5 ticket. Ted Nugent was there. John Cougar Mellencamp several times. Stephen Stills, Frankie Valli, and Hank Williams Jr. coming through there. The preacher man says it's the end of time, and the Mississippi River, she's a going dry. Phyllis Diller, Gabe Kaplan, Ricky Nelson doing four shows. I remember, I'm just a farm kid from Minnesota, and my mom and dad lived on a farm, and their son goes to the big city, and not quite sure what he's all about. I was working at Ford Motor Company at the time, and then they kind of found out that I was involved in some kind of a bar thing out here in Michigan. So they come out at one time, and I decided, well, I better spill the beans here and fill them in on what kind of what their son has gotten himself into. So I take him down, and it's Ricky Nelson. Well, let me tell you, my mother was the biggest fan of Ricky Nelson ever. So I talked to him prior to the show and tell him that my mom's going to be there, give him a little background on it all. And he says, "Great." I said, "You know, if you could recognize her," because, you know, most people in the place knew me at that time, that my mother was there, and, you know, to acknowledge her. So what does he do? But he brings her up on stage. I mean, he makes this big announcement about, you know, someone really special is here. Now, there's a woman from a little small town living on a farm that watches her black and white television, watching the Nelson family. He calls her up on stage and sets her on his knee and sings to her. Well, I can tell you, my dad's shooting pictures, and she showed those pictures to everybody in her hometown back in Minnesota for the next 10 years. I mean, if she had them at the ready, whoever she met. So very special moments like that that we had at Center Stage. And certainly, like Tina Turner, when Tina Turner came in, it was, I think, her second show coming back out without Ike. And she was... You wouldn't believe it today, but she was very nervous about doing that show prior to the show. She wanted to prove herself that she could be out there and be successful without Ike. But she didn't really have the confidence at that time that that was a done deal. after the show, she comes up and just thanks me profusely for taking a chance on her to do to book her at that club. Well, you know, from there, her career just really took off. She put on the most fantastic two-hour show you'd ever see. The Police played there on their initial tour, $5 ticket for the Police. And of course, 3 months later, they were playing Cobo Hall. I remember when Harry Chapin was in there, we had a double show that night. And wouldn't you know it, he decides to go over about an hour in the first show. Sunday night was always something, too. I mentioned earlier, we had Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday were big national acts. Thursday, Friday, and Saturday was Steve King and the Diddleys. Steve King and the Diddleys played there for the better part of 4 years, every Thursday, Friday, and Saturday night. But Sunday night was disco night. That's when disco was big. We would run up to over 2,000 people a night through that place on disco night. And all I had was a disc jockey spinning records and a mirror ball. And we could light that place up and put a couple thousand people in here. You charge $3 a head and drink all that much. They're a bunch of pretty people, but let me tell you, it was a lot of fun. So we did everything from Miss Michigan beauty pageants to shows to business seminars. To rock and roll shows, to country shows, to comedians, virtually anything that required a venue of 1,000 people. We even did Wide World of Sports. We did boxing matches in there, did WWE wrestling in there. It was ideal. The venue was ideal. They could set the cameras where they wanted to for filming. So ABC, Wide World of Sports, love to use the venue for those kinds of activities. So anyway, a lot of fun. It was a chapter of my life I wouldn't give up for anything, but I wouldn't go back to it either. It was a one-time deal. It was a great fun. It was a real challenge. Got it done, did it right, and then you move on.